I want you to start thinking on the things of you right now. I want you to set your mind on the things that you want to change in your life. Hallelujah. I want you to think on the things that have been holding you back for so long. Hallelujah. I want you to think on the things that have been a burden in your life. Hallelujah. And I want you to drop them at his doorstep on today. Hallelujah. Father, we are thankful for another opportunity to be in your presence. Father, I want to thank you for another opportunity to be in your presence, Father. Father, we come to you today, Father, as humbly as we know how. But, Father, also boldly to your throne of grace, Father. Father, for we know that if we are to make a petition to your court, Father, that we must come to you, Father, upright, Father. We must come to you, Father, direct, Father. Father, we must come to you in holiness, asking for exactly what we need, Father. Asking for exactly what we desire, Father. But first, Father, we want to align our desires with your desires, Father. We want to align our will with your will, Father. We want to align our thoughts with your thoughts, Father. Today, Father, we see you early, Father, where you can be found. Father, we ask on today, Father, if there's anybody who's dealing with sickness in the body, Father. Anyone who may be dealing with sickness in the mind, Father, that you touch, Father, right now and restore them right now, Father. Father, send them running back to you, Father. Father, you said that you will chase those that you love, Father. So we understand, Father, that things are falling apart in our lives because you're trying to break the chains that have been holding us for so long. And Father, we accept your chasing on the day, Father. Father, we accept your correction on the day, Father. Father, we accept your will on today, Father. We accept your thoughts on today, Father. We accept your way of doing things, Father. For we know that our way leads to destruction. And only your way leads to your divine light. So, Father, we thank you for that on today. Father, we thank you for that on today. Father, I ask that you remove those burdens, Father. Those burdensome thoughts, Father. Those feelings of feeling like we're not worthy, Father. Those feelings and those thoughts that lock us in a room, Father. Those feelings and those thoughts, Father, that keep us away from you, Father. We look to walk with you again in the garden. Here on earth, Father, we don't have to die to experience you, Father. We can experience you now. For you said that you are not the Father of the dead, but you are the Father of the living. So today, Father, we accept your life. On today, Father, we accept your light. We accept the breath that you breathed into us, Father, when we were first created. Father, we thank you, Father. We thank you for all that you are, Father. Oh, Father, I feel you doing something on today, Father, and I won't move, Father, until you tell me to move. Father, I won't move until you tell me to move, Father. This isn't about me, Father. This isn't really about us, Father, but this is about what you want to do in our life, Father. Father, I understand that we think we know who we are, Father, but nobody knows us like the manufacturer. Nobody knows us like our creator. So today, Father, we come back to the factory so that we may be molded and mended and broken and put back together, that we shall be found beautiful in your sight. Father, we thank you for all the things that you do. In your mighty name we pray. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Let's give him a hand clap for you. Hallelujah. I'm thankful for another opportunity to be in the presence of the Lord. I want to welcome everybody to the wave. But we do nothing more but to seek his kingdom and put his kingdom first. Well, we know that if we put his kingdom first, then all that other stuff will come later. I'm going to call it stuff today. I ain't even going to call it things because that ain't what I'm focused on today. I'm focused on how we can get back aligned with who he is. And that should be our thought process on every day. But we won't keep the service any longer. At this time, we're going to call the bishop to give us a scripture and a few words. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Oh, bless the Lord.
Oh, bless the Lord. Hallelujah.
Yes. Oh, that is.
And all that is within me, bless his holy name.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Amen. We give our hearts to the Lord and say, and being able to see all of you. I am so glad that he has allowed us to find a place where we all can come and associate.
Hallelujah.
That we can lift him up.
Yes, yes.
And praise. We don't have the orchestra and all that stuff.
All right.
Come on.
But we come to show the real purpose.
Yes, yes, yes.
Come on, come on.
Of why we do this.
Come on.
Amen. You know, the other thing that we contribute, and whatever we contribute, it benefits.
Come on. Come on.
That's it.
Come on.
You know, the Bible speak of 10%.
Come on.
And you can't get rid of the fact of 10%.
Come on.
But there's a purpose for that.
Uh-oh. Come on.
And the reason why I mention the 10% is that I want you to understand that because 10%, which everybody don't understand the whole purpose of 10%, but 10% is not like you sow a seed today and reap tomorrow.
Come on.
That's right. That's right.
Come on. Come on.
I think he misses it.
Come on. Come on.
You understand?
That's it. Come on.
It has everything to do with the life we live.
Come on.
I begin to look at the Apostle Paul explaining that. And if you run down the reference of being a church of people,
come on.
It'll tell you something.
Yeah, it will. Yeah, it will.
Man, we thank God today. I just want to say that. And I know on last Sunday, I probably said some things. They said, what this crazy man talking about? But I started talking about spectrum cell.
Come on.
You know, and all that stuff. Only thing I'm talking about is that we. Sometimes, every time we open our mouth, it's Jesus this and Jesus that and Jesus this and Jesus that. And that's been going on since I was a little boy. And many I haven't seen prosper from what they were saying. Mm. Jesus didn't say all that when he came. Mm-hmm.
Come on.
He started exercising the purpose of why the Father sent.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the only thing I was saying is, man, when you go to the Bahamas, man, you don't look for a prime minister. You go out there and look for that clear water,
come
and
on.
Sandy beaches, all mm-hmm. that. You understand what I'm saying?
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah. Man, you go to Shaolin for the mayor. But it's all over. That's all I'm saying. You're looking for the benefits of what it's worth. But you have to put something in. You have to change your mind. Man, I thank God for Jesus. I haven't felt like running through the truth, leaving the old wall this week.
Mm-hmm.
Matter of fact, I went to see a physician.
Come on.
And they didn't tell me to my life.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, tell me I wasn't sick. I told myself, I don't feel good. I told my friend that I said, I don't feel good. I said, my head is hurting me.
Mm-hmm.
My blood pressure is good and everything like that. And so they told me to prescribe me Tylenol, told me to take some of the stuff that I already had and what I'm against my pain. And I said, Doctor, wait a minute.
Come on. Sometimes you got to talk to the doctor. Come on.
I said, wait a minute. I said, my head hurting me.
Mm-hmm.
And I came to the doctor.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, and you telling me to get some Tylenol? Ain't you got some?
Come on.
I said, I need something for my head right now.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Everybody laughing at me thought I was crazy, right? No, man. You ain't got no Tylenol.
Come on.
Mm-hmm. I said, my head hurt right now.
Right.
I need something right now.
That's right. Right now.
It went and found me some Tylenol. Man, it was just kind of, you know.
That's good, though.
It really ain't a lot of money, really. I mean, really, I went there to feel better.
Right.
Anyway, y'all know what I am. But I thank God for Jesus. He's good. I mean, I didn't get a relief until I consulted him.
Come on.
Yeah.
Come on.
And it was about Wednesday night. I'm still having the same symptoms. And I wanted to work.
Come on.
And I needed to work Friday and Saturday. I said, Lord, so about that Wednesday, I'm still feeling the same way. I said, Lord, wait a minute. I said, now, you said if we line up with your righteousness.
Come on. That's what you said. Come on.
And walk according to your statutes.
That's right.
We can ask
anything. Come on.
In your name.
That's it.
And you would do it.
That's it. Come on.
And I thought about that song, John G.P. sang. Show up. I said, Lord, I need you to show up.
That's right. That's right.
I'm being serious. I said, I need you to show up.
That's it.
So later on, Sister Pam asked me how I feel. And I said, you sure?
Come on!
Amen.
Come on.
I went and drove in front.
Uh-huh.
Amen. So let me get out of the way, so Pastor, come on. Amen. I'm going to look at the scripture from St. John chapter 17. St. John chapter 17. We're going to begin at verse 1. Very familiar passage. And if you had your Facebook, it wouldn't take you that long to get it.
Come on.
These words spake Jesus, lift up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour is come.
Come on.
Glorify thy Son, that the Son also may glorify thee, as thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent.
Mm-hmm.
I have glorified thee on the earth. I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. I'd like to put something else in it. Before the world was. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I don't know what we're waiting on.
That's right.
I don't know what we're waiting on.
Come on.
And that we need to change our way of thinking.
Yes.
And we need to use the manual that he gave us. I don't care what they say out there.
Right.
We need to use this manual. We need to walk by this manual. I don't care what your job says. I don't care what Washington says. I don't care what anybody says. we are supposed to go by this man. And it dare you to be rebellious either.
Right.
We have to respect the order of what's out there and understand it, because when they come against Jesus and they were doing the taxes, he didn't refuse it.
Come on.
He told Simon, go down there and get that money out of the fishing mouth and pay taxes for you and I.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Do y'all hear what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Man. But we are, we can't do like the world and expect to get heavenly results.
We're not going to keep the service too much longer. At this time, we'll call up Jay. My brother Jay is going to give us a few words.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'm grateful to be amongst the living again.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Because I remember when I was just dying.
Come on.
Arise, lift up the lad and hold him in thine hand, for for I will make him a great nation. And God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water, and she went and filled the bottle with water and gave the lad a drink. So in our life, we experience similar things like Hagar. So she was just in a comfortable situation. She had everything going for her. She knew what was going on. She could predict what was going to happen. But now she's moving into the wilderness, and she don't know how anything's going to happen. So she's fearful, and she's scared. But God is still going to move in her life and do something great through her son, which she's thinking is going to, she don't really understand how it's going to happen. So here we see that she can't even see the access and the opportunity that she has to water around her, but she's crying about, scared she's going to die, but there's water right here, but she can't see it because that's not her focus. So God had to open her eyes and show her there's a well of water right here.
Come on.
The next scripture I'm going to read is Psalms 55 and 22. You can't see it because you're in your feelings. The scripture tells us, cast your burden on the Lord, and he shall sustain you. He shall never permit the righteous to be moved. And another tells us that to cast your cares upon him because he cares for you. But we also need to care about ourselves. Philippians 4 and 6 through 7 says, be anxious for nothing, but everything by prayer and supplication. With thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Do you really want what you're asking God for? Do you really want to be made whole? Do you really want to move on to the new? Get out of your feelings and get out of the way. We tell God we'll give him our life and to have his way, but when his way is shown to us, it doesn't feel good. So we respond the same way we would in the past with somebody else, but we are supposed to be a new creation. But all of that starts by mindset. The way you think about anything is what and how you're going to go about it. This is the importance of having your mind renewed. Romans 12 and 2 tells us, and be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. God has so much in store for us, more than we can imagine, beyond the visions he has even given us. But it's going to take a lot to get there, and it's not always going to feel good. But we must get rid of the past and our carnal way of thinking. Being focused on the present opportunity and being grateful for the moment that you have now. Everything you have now and looking on to the future. When you're doing things right, when you're doing right, things are going to happen to try to throw you off course. But God wants to see if you're going to stand or not. It's all about your mindset. And Peter, 1 Peter 4 and 12 through 19 tells us, beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened unto you, but rejoice, inasmuch as ye are partakers of Christ's sufferings, that when this glory shall be revealed, you may be glad also with exceeding joy. If you be reproached for the name of Christ, happy are ye, for the spirit of glory and of God rest upon you. And there, on their part he is evil spoken of, but on your part he is glorified. But let none of you suffer as a murderer, or as a thief, or as an evildoer, or as a busybody in other men's matters. Yet, if any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on his behalf. For the time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it first begin at us, what shall the end of them be that obey not the gospel of God? And if the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear? Wherefore, let them that suffer according to the will of God commit the keeping of their souls to him in well-doing as unto a faithful Creator. Are you going to seek him in it or not? He's eager to elevate you so that way you won't even be shaken by anything. You'll always have peace. That's more valuable than anything you can ask for. To be unshakable, he's just waiting to see if we are ready, and it all starts with our mindset and seeking him first in his righteousness so everything else can be added. What does it profit a man to gain the whole world but lose his soul? That's what happens when you do it backwards. You're trying to get the things first, but you're sacrificing your soul on behalf of that. Things aren't as much of a necessity as the fruits of the Spirit are. God's ways are more important than our own. The reason you're stressed out and worried is because you're more focused on things than God. Our emotions and connection with our past have to cease and allow the newness of God to consume our entire being. And at this moment, I believe we can call up our pastor.
Hallelujah. I think we had like the first.
How y'all feel over there? Good. Yeah, I can't let this stuff feel something. Like I need to pass out some coffee. to get out of your way. I know that this is a 4-day weekend. Y'all ready to eat, kick back, relax, and enjoy yourself. So I'm going to touch on a few points, and I'm going to get out of y'all way. So two different people came up here and spoke. I want y'all to know that those two different people didn't even talk to each other. Bishop spoke on being a cheerleader, which is funny, and I'm going to touch on that in a second. And Jay spoke on being stuck in the past. My question is, how is this possible? How can you be stuck in the past? How is that even a possible thing? It's because both of these things they spoke about is a mindset. Both of these things are no more than a mindset. And it's so funny that Bishop got up here and he spoke about being a cheerful giver, because I had a conversation with a brother of mine yesterday. We had a good kind of long conversation about something aligning to these lines. And we built together. He saw something one way, and I saw something another way. But we reasoned on the telephone. We reasoned with each other and came, and we went back to the Word to see what the Word actually says. Alignment means everything. Being aligned means everything. Neither one of us talked about what we was going to do up here, and that's always on purpose. Because I want us to always be moving in the Spirit, and I don't want to say, okay, y'all, let's talk about this. Because that might not be what God wants you to talk about. So being aligned means everything. This is the very reason why we're able to test the Spirit by the Spirit. Because if you test the Spirit and it's not aligning with the Spirit in you or the Holy Spirit, you can see that it's not in alignment and it's something ain't right. Y'all speak. It's okay. But let's get into it. Aligning your thoughts. Go ahead to the next slide. Scripture says, look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ. Now I know many ways y'all have heard this scripture probably 1,000 times, but you're going to hear it 1,001. There's a reason why things are repetitive. And I keep telling y'all the same thing over and over again. He said, he'll move when you move. That's why you feel like he ain't talking to you, because you ain't did the last thing he told you to do. Yeah. So that's the reason why you keep hearing these same things over and over again. But next slide. This scripture is aligning you with a right thought process. Let me tell you why. This morning I had to get up and I had to go clean the store. But I want to tell you something. Before I got up to clean the store, I saw today. That sounds crazy to religious people. I saw today happening before it happened. I knew exactly, I got a phone call this morning and I knew exactly what they were going to say on the phone call. It was almost like the vision that I had last night was continuing on into reality. Mm-hmm. I knew exactly what was going to take place. But I've never experienced it this detail before. But I started noticing that the more that I align myself with his thoughts, the clearer everything seems to be. So this morning, I'm cleaning up the store. And I was passing these soda cups and bottles and things. And I started saying, Primark don't even sell it. I didn't mean to say the name. But this store don't even sell this stuff. And the Holy Spirit began to deal with me. And he said, this is somebody else's mess. Have you ever had to clean up somebody else's mess? How did it make you feel? Do you know that selfishness makes other people clean up your mess? This is why he said, let this thought process be in you that was also with Christ. He's telling us to align our thoughts with the thoughts that Christ had when he walked here. Next slide. Being selfish is a mindset. This mindset is so dangerous because it places you in a position to view things differently. This mindset is so powerful, it doesn't just have the ability to hold you back. It will cause you to manipulate others and hold them back. I'll give you an example. Has anyone ever broke up, like somebody broke up with you? And then you get with somebody else, then all of a sudden they want you back? Y'all don't find that strange? It's not because they want you back, they just don't want nobody else to have you.
That's what a selfish mindset will do for you. It'll make you hold on to things that you don't even want no more. It's next slide. Your mindset determines how you see things, and how you see things determines how you live. This process is called thought process for thoughts. Y'all with me? Next slide. Proverbs 23:7 says, "For as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. Eat and drink, said he to thee, but his heart is not with thee." Eat and drink with them if you want to, but their heart is not with them. Get information from them if you want to, but that information didn't come from me. I'm going to get y'all on the second here. Y'all going to get with me if you want me to. This is the reason why he said, "At all things, guard your heart." I told you that the heart has a mind in it. Your mind ain't up here. This is just a database to hold information. Your thought process happens right here in your heart. It's called the subconscious mind. Next slide. The top athletes understand that it is just as important to strengthen their mind as well as their body. I done told y'all before about this thing called muscle memory. And that muscle memory process that it's talking about is the heart, because the heart is a muscle. And when you start strengthening that muscle, what happens is it'll overcome your body. Even when you don't feel like doing anything. A marathon runner doesn't train for the day that he runs. Listen. He's not training his body just for the day that he's running. He's training his mind at all times. This is why they wake up every morning and run and don't skip a day. I told y'all I love taking beach trips more than anything because it convicts me. Every time I go to the beach, I want to look like everybody else. I'm going to take my shirt off. But what's going to determine whether or not I can take my shirt off is how I've been living before I got to that beach. You can't show up at the beach and just think you got beach body. Which means when I'm not at the beach, I got to prepare myself before I get there. But what's keeping me from this beach body? Oh man, it's laziness. The laziness is a mindset. You ever went to the gym and turned around and left because you said, "Man, I got to do this every day"? Just me. Well, I want to take another. I just took a shower. I got to go work out and take another shower. You know what? I'm going to skip today. It's a mindset. Next slide. Romans 12:1-2 says, "I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service." Pause. Bishop talked about that 10%. I know y'all hate to hear about it. I had a whole conversation yesterday about giving. Do you not understand that giving ain't got nothing to do with money?
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Giving has nothing to do with money, even though he's making you give money. It has nothing to do with money. It's about breaking things off of you. In order for us to understand this, let's go back to Cain and Abel. They both gave. Both of them gave, but one was acceptable. Why? It's because he aligned his thoughts and his ways with God. He obeyed. Obedience is about aligning yourself with his ultimate will. "And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." That you may prove what's good. There must be fruit. There must be evidence of something good. Why would you pick up the phone and call somebody and call somebody seeking advice on a situation that they have no level of understanding in? You know how dangerous that is? Do you know where have they proven good to you in that area? There must be Next slide. Practice. Growing up, I used to hate practice, but I loved the games. I hated practice, but I loved the games. Because at the games, there's people in the stands. There are people cheering for you. You get all types of accolades. But when you're in practice, ain't nobody in there but a coach yelling at you. Yeah. That don't sound familiar. See, it's in practice where you craft your skill. It's in practice when people ain't around that you build up your endurance. It's in practice where you start getting your mind together. Whether somebody's in the stands or they ain't in the stands, you perform the same. See, we got that problem even in the building. We judge how we worship based upon how many people show up.
I told y'all we'll get you.
Boy, if these seats was, all these seats was filled, I wouldn't have to yell at y'all for an amen.
Go ahead.
Because it starts here.
Right.
It starts here. This is why he said where two or three are gathered. He didn't say 20 or 30.
That's right.
It's a mindset. Where two or three are gathered. I'm there. You don't need 1,500 people. All I need is two or three to get the work done. Yeah. Get your mind right. My coaches used to always tell me how you practice is how you play. I used to say, man, whatever. That's what kids say. When I was a child, I thought as a child, man, this practice ain't got nothing to do with how I'm playing the game. But it does. What you practice every day is what you're comfortable performing. Y'all listen to me. That's why when somebody walk up to you and want to talk Bible with you, you get upset. It's because you ain't got practice in Bible. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Boy, one of them Hebrew Israelites or a Muslim or somebody run up on you, you in trouble. Because you don't got no practice. And if you ain't careful, they might convert you. When you continually do something, it becomes second nature to you. Everything God asks us to do is to train our mind to have the correct thought process. I just did it to you right now. How did I do it? I just did it to you. Did anybody catch it? I said God to y'all, but up here it say y'all. I'm going to get y'all. Y'all going to wake up. I just read God, but that thing say God. Subconsciously, I made you read his name while you still said God. Everything he does is to train our mind to have the correct thought process. He's not asking you to give because he needs. He's asking you to give to break selfishness off of your life. Every time it's time for you to give, there's thoughts that go in your head. Man, this joker probably already got a job. Or he need to go get a job. Or he probably got a car around the corner. These are thoughts that go through your head. Why does that matter? If you feeling led to give, give. How come you got to have a whole conversation with yourself whether or not you're going to do it? All that stuff starts in the mind. That's why when Christ came, he said, he was telling y'all that sin has risen in the world. So things are worse. It's now at the point that you don't even got to sleep with the woman. All you got to do is think about her and it's already done. Right. Mm-hmm. Next slide. Isaiah 55 and 89 says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, said the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways. And my thoughts, then your thoughts. Next slide. Thoughts. We have talked about your ways and being aligned with your ways and being aligned with the ways of God for about a year. But now we're going to focus on the reason why you aren't you're not able to align your ways with his ways. And that reason is the first thing he said, because your thoughts are not his thoughts. They're supposed to be. But they're not. Amen. Why? Y'all think God randomly say stuff? Why he say, let every man be a lie and not be the truth? Why he say that? Why he say that? Because he don't want you seeking nobody else for no information. If they don't align with me, you ain't got no business listening to him. He could have just said that, and because it means the same thing. I'm the source of truth. His son came and said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Today we're going to focus on the thoughts. What are thoughts? The word thoughts is the Hebrew word makashaba, which means contrivance, intention, plan, and plot, and advice. Advice. Advice means guidance or recommendation offered in regard to further action. Let me say that again. It is guidance or recommendations offered in regard to future actions. Advice can be the most dangerous tool, the most dangerous tool in Satan's bag. Advice can be the most dangerous tool in Satan's bag. This is why backbiting is so bad. Because you can backbite and give advice at the same time. Who you get advice from is very important. There are so many things that seem right and seem to make sense. So many things that seem right and seem to make sense. This is why he says that there's ways that seem right to a man but lead to destruction. Proverbs is the book of wise counsel or advice. Did y'all know that? That's what it's called. The letters that he wrote were called the letters of wise counsel or advice. The reason we can't trust this advice is because it came from, the reason we can trust this advice in Proverbs is because it came from Solomon. That's why you can trust it. And you know that Solomon got his wisdom from who? God. We know it didn't come from nobody else. It says that God asked him, what do he want? And out of all the things he asked for wisdom, which means his wisdom came from God. Hence, the letters were called the book of the letters of wisdom or advice. Alright? Let's look at every description of thought so that we can get a clear understanding. Next slide, I'm sorry. We can get a clear understanding of how to align our thoughts with God's. With Yah's thoughts. Next slide. Contravance. If I'm not saying that word right, don't blame me. Blame my third grade teacher. That word means the use of skill to bring something about or create something. Bishop was up here earlier, and he was talking about being sick. He said he went to the doctor. He told him, I don't feel good. And I need something now. But what I want y'all to understand is, Bishop was sick last week too. And he didn't not come up here because he was sick. He came up here with a different mindset. Let me tell you something. There are people who will call out for a runny nose. They'll call out of work for a runny nose. And there are people who will go to work with a broken ankle. You hear me? Both people, two different mindsets. Because he understood that you can think yourself sicker than what you already are. Philippians 4:8 says, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think on these things. He didn't put in here, think of anything negative.
Right.
So why are you doing it? He didn't say that bad things won't arise. He just says, don't think on them. This is why the scripture says, cast down every vain imagination. If you allow that stuff in your mind to circle around, it becomes your thought process. You can't do stuff because you think you can't do stuff. And then you say you can't do stuff. Now you definitely can't do stuff. Next slide. Those things which he had both. both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do. Those things which you have both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do. Why in the world did he go through three different phases in order for him to say do? Because he said, you have both learned and received. Then he gave you evidence. He said, you have also seen. And the God of peace shall be with you. But I rejoice in the Lord greatly that now at the last you care of me have flourished in you. Wherein you were also careful, be ye lack opportunity. Not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned, watch this, in whatsoever state I am in, therewith to be continued. How does a man even speak? Whatever manner of, what, it don't even matter what I'm in. I know how to be content. If I had mistaken, he would locked up at this time. He said, it don't matter what condition I'm in. I know how to be content. Which means my thought process is so strong, it don't matter what it looked like around me. I'm okay. Next slide. I know both how to be abased and I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. The reason why you can't do it is because you don't believe you can do it. Because you don't know how to be both broke and rich. When you rich, you run from the church. When you broke, you run from the church. You only know how to stay in the middle when you come in here. Some of us only pray when we in need. Some of us only give thanks when he gives. He's telling you, once you have his mindset, there ain't nothing stopping you from doing nothing. This is how you know you can do all things through Christ. Because no matter if you're up or down, it don't mean you can't do it. It just means you ain't did it yet.
Right.
Next slide. Bold. I got a couple more, y'all. Let me get out y'all. Bold, and I ain't gonna finish today. We went bowling on Friday night, and I had a slow start. I'm talking about I couldn't hit a pin and save it or do nothing. Then around about the middle of the game, the Holy Spirit started moving. Y'all don't find that strange that I be telling y'all that my messages come from the strangest things? Everyday life. I didn't say I was reading the Bible, I said I was bowling. But I got the mindset that I know in all things I can find him. So that's why he was able to deal with me when I was bowling. But anyway, he started dealing with me. He said, all right, you've been playing long enough. This is what I want you to do. I want you to slow down, and I want you to do the things you practiced when you used to bowl. And I began to do them things. And as soon as I started doing it, my game started getting better. The more that I started blocking out the noise, because I was focused on how everybody else was going. Oh man, they were hot. They were hot Friday night too, Bishop. They was in there showing out. And I was behind, and I got caught up in what everybody else was doing. All I could think about and all I could see was how good everybody else was performing. And the better they performed, it seemed like the worse I did. But as soon as the Holy Spirit convicted me and changed my thoughts, I began to perform better. Because I felt myself feeling discouraged, y'all. Y'all know discouragement is a real thing.
Yes.
Huh? Yes. It's something we deal with every day, feeling like we're less than. It's because we're looking at everything else and we allow the enemy to fill our thoughts with, you ain't good enough. Who told you you can do that? You know you messed up yesterday. I wouldn't even pray today if I was you. You ain't gonna hear you anyway. You start feeling discouraged looking at what's going on. But anyway, so I started to bow and I started winning. And the more I started winning, the more encouraged I started feeling, because I started seeing evidence of the thoughts that I had. And I won 2 games too, Bishop. Whatever you focus on and put your mind on will control how you will perform in life. This is a fact. If you send your kids to school feeling dumb, they're going to be dumb in the building. If you ain't encouraging your child and pouring into them before they leave the house, they in trouble when they reach the school.
Yes.
Only 10% of them teachers going to take the time to say, hey, listen, come here. Let me talk to you. You better than this. You stronger than this. You smarter than this. You ain't bad. You got good behavior. You ain't. They going to say, no, you bad. Go to somebody else's room. How you think is how you perform. If you don't learn to cast down those vain imaginations, y'all, I'm telling you they vain. How do I know they vain? Because of this scripture. He said, before I formed you, I knew you. And I had an expected end for you. This ain't the world talking. This is God talking. His expected end is only glory. So how can we even have the thought that we lived in? Next slide. Intention. Intention comes from the root word intent. Intent means purpose. Intent means resolve or determined to do something. Intent means showing earnest and eager attention. Next slide. Romans 12:1-2. I'm almost done. And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies a living sacrifice. To give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind you will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. Giving your body to things and people is worship. This is truly the way to worship him. Don't copy the behavior and customs of the world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. It's got to start here. I keep pointing here because y'all can't see my heart, but y'all know what I'm talking about. We got to allow him to change that mindset. And changing that mindset means sometimes people got to go away for a little bit so that he can talk to you, so that he can get in your mind, so that he can connect with you. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. I ain't going to finish this, so I'm going to have to do a part two, but I wanted to read something with y'all when it comes to alignment, to show y'all something that he showed me while I was sitting there. All right. So when I looked up the word align, it has a multitude of meanings. One of those meanings was to put things in a straight line. Alignment with his thoughts means to put you in a straight line. So if you feel yourself going left and right, you know you're not aligned. Y'all be listening. If you feel like you're all over the place, the scripture says that a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. Not some of them. All his ways. So that means you can't have the mind of the world and the mind of God. And if you have the mind of the world and the mind of God, that's the reason you're unstable. That's the reason why you can't make ends meet. Now, what did I say? All right, the second thing that aligned me, it says to agree or to be similar to. Then the example they gave says the post was deleted because it did not align with the values of the website. Sometimes you're being blocked because you ain't in alignment. You're not aligning yourself with his word, so how in the world is he going to continue to move you in a direction when you're moving in the wrong direction? You're moving in the wrong way. He's not going to continue to allow you to do something and harm yourself. Scripture says that he kicked them out the garden because if he didn't, they would have continued in sin. One of the examples I just felt was good. One of them was a probiotic medication. One of them was to help with sickness. One of the meanings of a line is to help with sickness.
It's good to me. Y'all ain't got to take it. It's good for me.
Another example of a line was a cubic measure. It means to combine or to rotate or to move and command it to align.
That's good.
Align also is a shoe brand. It is to support. They made the shoe to support bad feet. So just in case you don't feel like walking and you want to complain about an ache, they made a shoe that will align you with his thoughts so you can keep on moving.
That's good.
I got two more.
A bishop is also a teeth straightening system. He's the one straightening up the teeth. So you chew right. So people ain't talking about your teeth and you ain't got to worry about folks. The last one was a strategic growth management system. It's a strategic growth management system. It's used to make sure that you're growing at a rapid pace. It's used to make sure that you're growing and not staying the same.
That's good. Y'all mess with somebody else.
So y'all, we gotta learn how to align our thoughts with his thoughts. And that is the only way we're gonna be able to move in his ways. Because until you learn that it starts in your mind, then you're going to be stuck in the past, like Brother Jameson. You hear me? You're going to be stuck feeling bad that you can't give. You're going to be, come on y'all, I'm trying to help you. If you don't fix that thought process, you're going to continue in the way that you always did things. So let's align ourselves with his way.
Hallelujah.
We're thankful for his word on the day. I hope you said something that was edifying to y'all. At this time, we are going to take up a little offering. The Cash App is $ this is the wave. Again, it's $ this is the wave. If anybody needs an envelope, please let me know. I'll bring it to you. Dylan, believe.
understand, Father, that many of us don't have, Father. We understand, Father, that it is a struggle sometimes, Father, in this economy we're living in. But, Father, we understand, Father, just because we live in this economy doesn't mean it's our economy. Father, for we live in the kingdom economy, and the kingdom doesn't go without. The kingdom doesn't suffer lack. So, Father, we are thankful for the mindset, Father, of the kingdom. We are thankful today, Father, for what we are given, Father. We ask today, Father, that you increase on this gift, Father. Father, we understand that when we give, Father, it's not necessarily, Father, for you, Father, but for your people, Father, who are in need. So, Father, on today, Father, we ask that you continue to touch our hearts and our minds, Father, that we may give, Father, cheerfully, Father, standing upright, Father. Father, we thank you and we love you. In your mighty name we pray. Hallelujah. Show them, Father, that we give you all things for your Son who you sent to die for us, Father. Father, we are thankful for that on today. Father, we also ask, Father, if there's anybody dealing with any sickness in the body, Father, or sickness in the mind, that you touch and you heal, Father. We're not asking you to do something that you haven't done before, but we're just asking you to be who you are. For you said you are the great I am. Whatever we can ever need or ask for, you are that. So, Father, we love you and we thank you. Father, we ask that we leave this place that we never leave your presence. In the mighty name we pray. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We do this every Friday at 7:45. Services at 1 o'clock on Sundays at the building. It is 10:30. Central Drive. Service begins at 1 o'clock. We love y'all and we'll see y'all next time. Shalom.